welcome Periscope viewers, as well as those who are here in person. So virtuality and reality to the Edmonton Social Planning Council's annual general meeting and excellent speech, or as we like to call it, this is the cool part of the evening.
This is a lot to live up to.
Our keynote speaker is Paula Simons, who is no stranger to all of us as the Edmonton Journal City columnist, but you know, that really doesn't give the full Paula, does it? Because Paula is in the journal, Paula's on Twitter, on Facebook. Paula is one of the voices of our city, and particularly the voices of social justice, of reason and rationality, but also sometimes of an important emotional look at the issues too. Here is someone who has earned 5 national newspaper awards citations of merit for excellence in commentary and political reporting. In 2014, she was co-winner of the National Newspaper Award for Investigative Journalism for her work on the fatal care investigation into Alberta's troubled child welfare system. She's also been honored by the Canadian Bar Association, the Canadian Mental Health Association, the Alberta Centre for Civil Liberties Research, and Canada's Governor General for her writing on social justice and civil rights. She's a graduate of the University of Alberta and Stanford University, and one of Canada's most acclaimed journalists, and we're very fortunate to have her with us tonight. Title of her address is The Elimination Round, Why Idealism Isn't Always Ideal. And that's all we know about it, which is a wonderful teaser for the big reveal. Yeah. So Paula, please join us.
Thank you very much. They made me sign a disclaimer that if I slander or libel anyone, the Social Planning Council is not to be held liable for anything I say. And since I'm on Periscope, hi, I'm going to be extra special good, but not too good. And I'm hoping, you know, you may not love everything I have to say tonight, and that makes it better, because then we can have an argument about it afterwards. It's a very great honor to be here with you this evening, here in the beautiful Stanley Milner Library, and more powerfully, here on Treaty 6 land, the traditional territory of the Cree Nation. It has been a very hectic few weeks for us at the Edmonton Journal and the Edmonton Sun. The fires are still blazing, as you can smell when you go outside. And the focus for everyone has been the immediate crisis in Fort McMurray. And that's not just in our newsroom, that's in our whole city. Social agencies and not-for-profits across Edmonton have stepped up in this emergency. The Red Cross, the Edmonton Emergency Relief Society, and the Food Bank are in the forefront, of course. But there have been many others, too, from the Mennonite Center for Newcomers, to Islamic Family Social Services, to the Norwood Child and Family Resource Center, to the Treaty 8 Band Office, to the Pride Center, and many, many others. They've all been putting to use their skills and their connections. It's been a real test for the Edmonton not-for-profit sector, and a real tribute, too, I think, to its strength and capacity and its raw creativity in a crisis. It's been truly inspiring to see our city come together in this state of emergency. But as I have looked and been so impressed and so admiring of the energy I've seen out there in the last couple of weeks, there's been in the back of my mind this niggling question. Why is it that we can rally a community in the face of a sudden disaster, but we somehow lack the focus and the will to tackle more stubborn, chronic problems of homelessness, social dislocation, and poverty? It's not an easy question. I think the answers lie deep in our deepest human nature. First of all, of course, there's a novelty and an excitement that comes with this sort of emergency. We feel like we're suddenly on a war footing. It gives us this warm sense of camaraderie and connection. We're all in there in the trenches together. I think the second point is that the narrative of the Fort McMurray evacuees, at least in Alberta, is that they're blameless. I think it's all too easy for some people to point to regular homeless people and blame them for their poverty or their addiction or their mental illness or their quote-unquote poor choices. But Fort McMurray evacuees, many of the middle-class families inspired general empathy, not just patronizing sympathy. I think it's also important to note that this is a temporary situation, not a nagging long-term problem. It's a short, sharp shock, as Gilbert and Sullivan would put it, a crisis with a beginning and a middle and a foreseeable end. And it's a problem with a foreseeable solution. And I think, in a fourth and important way, the reason we react the way we do is because it's a tangible problem. People see specific things to do, practical, bite-sized ways to help in a concrete fashion. It's not just a theoretical problem, it's palpable. And there are tactile steps that really make a difference. So the question I put out there for you tonight is, how can we harness some of this community goodwill and good fellowship inspired by the Fort McMurray evacuation and deploy it long after the fires are out to serve us here in the longer term? Now, I was asked to come up with a title for this presentation several months ago. That's always a challenge, since I had no idea what I was going to talk about. That's the hardest part. So I came up with a title, it sounded so clever, The Elimination Round, Why Idealism Isn't Always Ideal. And luckily enough for me, that fits very nicely into our current situation. Because the title was really inspired by two stories, two narratives. And it goes back to 2009, when I covered the launch of the province's 10-year plan to end homelessness. Back then, that's five premiers ago, Ed Stelmach was premier, Yvonne Fritz was the Minister of Housing, and the centerpiece of their plan was a promise of $3.3 billion to build 8,000 new social housing units. And that announcement came hard on the heels of earlier vows by Edmonton City Council to end homelessness within a decade, 2 years sooner than the province was going to end homelessness. Now, I'm a journalist, and worse than that, I'm a political columnist. I am, in other words, a professional skeptic. Some might say a professional cynic. I drank in skepticism in my mother's milk. And if you've met my mother, you'd know that's not an exaggeration. So it's probably not surprising that when I look back at my coverage of that 2009 announcement, I see that I declared that it was, quote, too simplistic, and that I would not be jumping on the bandwagon. Housing first is a good place to start, I wrote back in 2009. But housing alone can't and won't solve homelessness. We can build 8,000 housing units or 80,000. We can increase welfare benefits, but if we don't address the intertwined problems of addiction and mental illness, we will still have street people on our streets. And so here we are, 7 years and five premiers later, and guess what? I don't think we've quite eliminated homelessness in Edmonton. If anything, anecdotally and statistically speaking, the problem may have even gotten worse. There are still anywhere, depending when you count, 2,000, 3,000, some might say with a shadow couch surfing population, as many as 4,000 homeless people on the streets of Edmonton. Certainly at Capital Region Housing, there's a wait list of more than 4,000 families on the wait list for affordable housing. And there's a wait list for long-term psychiatric patients at Alberta Hospital Edmonton, with every bed filled, and the long-promised renovations promised by health minister after health minister after health minister nowhere in sight. And so it's easy to see our 10-year plan to eliminate homelessness as a failure, or worse, a joke. That's certainly what inspired my cuddly, curmudgeonly National Post colleague Colby Kosh to lambaste the homeless promise in a particularly curmudgeonly Colby-esque column this past March. I'm going to quote from Colby now. If you're not familiar with Colby's rhetoric, you'll see what I mean when I say curmudgeonly. Quote, only a fool could ever have imagined that Edmonton or any other large city would end homelessness in 10 years or 20 or 30, except by means of fascist methods or wild, unforeseeable social change, Colby wrote. Nevertheless, this sappy utopian vision got a bunch of now superannuated Alberta politicians celebrated for their heroic visioniness. No one, he continued, is now eager to point out their humiliating total failure, to point out that an entire professional class collectively promised the public something specific and came nowhere close to delivering. They did not deliver half of what they promised, not a quarter, not a tenth. And Colby and I are of the same vintage, which means we've been doing this a long time. Except, on another very real level, the program wasn't a humiliating total failure at all. In fact, thousands of individuals were helped off the streets, into treatment, and into long-term housing stability. According to a 2014 report from the City of Edmonton, prepared, I do believe, with the research support of the Edmonton Social Planning Council, in the first 5 years of the initiative, the city found 2,178 permanent homes for 2,909 homeless individuals. Drive through Boyle-McCauley today, And you can see high quality housing stock the campaign helped to build, where Edmontonians now have safe homes. Individuals and families have been helped out of dire poverty into greater stability, security, and tranquility. Those are all good things, and they are all measurable, quantifiable, undeniable things. But because the program was oversold at the outset with absurd, over-the-top, intelligence-insulting rhetoric, it can now be retconned and recast as a total failure. The expectations were always impossible to meet, and as a result, everyone involved was set up for failure from the start. And I would put it to you that all that kind of overpromising does, in turn, is not to create idealism, but to breed more cynicism and defeatism. I know why politicians and social justice champions want to talk about eliminating homelessness in a decade. Setting that kind of lofty goal makes politicians feel good. It makes them feel important, and politicians do love to feel important. But I put it to you more subversively that beyond that, promising to end homelessness in 10 years sent an implicit coded message to the sort of comfortable suburbanites who were made uncomfortable by the sight of the homeless. Help us out, goes the message. It will make all those people who frighten you and disturb you and worry you magically go away. The subtle and not so subtle messaging wasn't just about helping the most vulnerable. It was about cleansing social blight off the streets and making Edmonton look more like Pleasantville and less like New York or Toronto. The not quite articulated goal, in other words, wasn't just to eliminate homelessness. It was, in effect, to eliminate the homeless themselves, or at least get them out of the Stanley Miller Library. But that goal wasn't just lofty or idealistic. It was destructively self-defeating. It was too big, too impossible, and in the end, not even particularly desirable. Of course, homelessness is about poverty and economic desperation. It's also about racism and inequality of opportunity and the generational ripple effects of colonialism and residential schools and centuries of cultural genocide. For some, particularly in Edmonton, it's also about the toxic post-traumatic stress of having served in the military or of growing up in a war zone. But regardless of ethnicity or personal background, by far the largest number of the homeless on our streets are mentally ill or addicted or both. They are on the streets because they are sick. Some desperately and dearly want the chance to get well, but others, too lost in madness, in despair, or addiction, are unwilling or unable to make that choice. Others are simply unwilling to sacrifice their personal autonomy to conform with our comfortable social norms. Whether permitting, and I've met these people, I used to think this was just a right-wing thing that conservative right-wingers said until you actually go out and talk to people. There are people, absolutely there are people, whether permitting, who actually prefer the anarchy and adventure of living rough in our river valley, at least compared to the social and physical constraints of supportive care. And even if we could round them all up and give them all shelter beds, or beds at Alberta Hospital for that matter, I'm not entirely certain that we have the right to house people in ways and places they don't want to be housed, just because our politicians have made an empty pledge. And at the end of the day, all a frankly laughable pledge like eliminating homelessness in 10 years really does is to leave people on the front lines delivering services demoralized and disappointed, and to give their critics ammunition to take easy shots. Now, we're doing it all over again. Not content to have failed utterly to eliminate homelessness in 10 years, we're going to eliminate poverty itself. Yes, yes, yes. Allegedly, Edmonton will become a kind of golden city on the hill, a big rock candy mountain paradise, the only place in the world where poverty does not exist. Well, I mean, maybe Sweden, but you know, but here. We're gonna be the Emerald City. We'll be the capital of the United Federation of Planets. We'll be utopia. I have to tell you, when politicians tell me that they're going to eliminate poverty in 10 years or eliminate poverty in a generation, I do not find myself inspired. I find myself exasperated. Promises like that don't get me all fired up to get out there and volunteer or donate or advocate. They insult my intelligence, and they should insult the intelligence of anybody who thinks seriously about social policy and social planning. It is the equivalent of a beauty pageant candidate pledging to bring world peace. It is rhetoric unmoored from reality. Let us stop lying to ourselves and to our community. We are not going to eliminate poverty in a decade or a generation by handing out discount bus passes or building pod apartments or even by raising the minimum wage to $15 an hour. We are again setting ourselves up to fail and preloading a kind of mighty public backlash of cynicism and derision. And to come back to where I started, it's just this kind of pie-in-the-sky, grandiose, and frankly delusional rhetoric that turns people off and discourages them from wanting to help. If we want to inspire Edmontonians to real action, if we want to rally our community to long-term success, the way we have rallied in response to Fort McMurray, and the way we have rallied to South Syrian refugees, we have to give the people of Edmonton concrete, tangible goals. We have to give them ways to feel personally useful and personally engaged. One of my very favorite works of literature and of moral philosophy, if I can be so grand, is Voltaire's magnificent Candide. I don't know how well you know Candide. Everybody should read it. Not everybody does. In case you haven't, it is not quite a novel. It's more a blistering political and social satire in the form of a picaresque adventure story. It's the tale of a young man named Candide, a naive boy, handsome, kindly, and too pure to tell a lie. He has a sweetheart, Cunegonde, the lovely daughter of the Baron of Tundertentrocken. When their illicit romance is discovered, Candide is forced into exile and dangerous military service. Meanwhile, the Baron's castle in Westphalia is attacked, Cunegonde captured, and forced into sexual slavery. And from there, things really go downhill. Voltaire throws his young hero and heroine into every possible worst-case scenario the 18th century has to offer. Candide survives bloody battlefields, the deadly Lisbon earthquake of 1755. He is tortured by the Spanish Inquisition, captured by pirates, shipwrecked, robbed, betrayed. He, Cunegonde, and their insufferably cheerful tutor, Pangloss, cheat death over and over again. It's like a Coen Brothers movie, the violence so extreme it becomes ridiculous. Voltaire takes shots at Catholicism, Protestantism, Islam, Judaism, Manichaeism, and pretty much every other philosophical, political, and ideological ism the Age of Enlightenment had on offer. And after an absurd and gory series of misadventures stretching from Peru to Paris, Candide and his friends find a home in Turkey, where they meet a contented farmer who gives Candide his secret to happiness. We must cultivate our garden. What did Voltaire mean by that? We should cut ourselves off from the world and its problems? That we should go back to the land and embrace the simple life? I don't think so. The gloss I like to put on Candide is not that we should endure the injustice and the suffering in the world around us, but that we should be very skeptical of grand philosophies and doctrines and ideologies that promise easy, safe answers. Instead, I think the message of Candide is that we need to work on pragmatic, manageable scales to improve the lives of the people right around us. Saving the world is too big a task for anyone. So is eliminating poverty, in a generation at least. But we can each of us tend our garden, the part of the world closest to us, with love and hope and diligence. We can make smart, strategic, pragmatic changes that build social resilience and social capacity. Changes that give people more choices and more control over their lives. We can set attainable goals and work hard to attain them. We could, just by way of an example, make long-term reliable birth control and family planning education more accessible and more affordable for young women, because we know from evidence all around the world that when you give women true reproductive choice, you don't just empower them to make wise decisions for their families, you improve their economic status and the status of those around them. We could improve prenatal and postnatal care for young mothers and fathers to help ensure kids are born healthy and stay healthy and get off to the best possible start. We could better fund Head Start programs and all-day kindergartens and intensive literacy programs in at-risk neighborhoods. We could teach families how to cook and how to shop for food, giving them the basic food literacy skills to eat well and healthily on a budget. And given how many kids in this city drop out of school before they even finish junior high, we can put more social supports in place for young teens to help them get through those difficult junior high years and prepare them for success in high school. It's just a handful of tiny examples of the kind of simple, cost-effective interventions we could champion to build strong, healthy families and set a next generation on a path to success. are the sort of concrete initiatives that could really inspire people across the community to dig in to help. And you, at the Edmonton Social Planning Council, already know that. You are all about research and analytics and evidence-based policy formulation. We need you as leaders in our community to be providing us with objective data, solid evidence, so that we can make the smartest strategic interventions that will have the best measurable success. We rely on you and the work you do, your accurate information, as much as we do your impassioned advocacy. So I ask you and all those who support you, don't fall under the spell of the snake oil salesman and the political wizards who have magic answers for complex problems. Don't feel pressured into endorsing feel-good crusades at the expense of your own common sense and your own expertise. And don't, please don't alienate potential allies by promising the moon when we need first to get ourselves up off the ground. You don't want to make people, whether they're your donors, your volunteers, your frontline staff, or your clients, feel helpless. You don't want to make them feel like failures who can never live up to these great expectations. You want to empower them. And you do that by giving them the skills, the capacity, and the direction to make a real difference in the here and now. You harness their idealism and their passion and their commitment and help them to put them to work pragmatically. You help them, in other words, to cultivate their gardens, seed by seed, row by row, plot by plot. And who knows what the harvest of potential might be. To all of you from the Edmonton Social Planning Council, thank you for all that you do and all you have done year in and year out to make Edmonton a more just, a more fair, a more tolerant, and a more humane city for everyone who lives here. And I thank you for your patience and good humor tonight. I suspect that many of you will have been disagreeing quite passionately with my argument, and so I'm especially grateful that you allowed me here to speak to you tonight. It has been an honor and a privilege, and most of all, a pleasure. And I look forward to many passionate arguments in the days, weeks, and years to come about how to make Edmonton the place we know it can be. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for that wonderful presentation. I really enjoyed it. Some wonderful thoughts and great inspiration for all of us, I think. Thank you very much.
I do thank you very much. I know when you fall in my shoes right now, you pushed me that far over the edge. Actually, she pushed me that far over the edge 2 months ago when she gave me the title that she wanted to talk about.
This is like, and I'm like, you know that we support those things, right?
It's on the website.
I made the mistake. She's like, tell me a little more about your organization. So I start telling her about our organization and all the great work we're doing, and then she sends me this note back saying, I'm a little grumpy with organizations right now. I think they can eliminate poverty in a generation. And I'm thinking, you proved to be one of our most interesting speakers, and you certainly have been, and I thank you very much. I read your column every day. My 90-year-old mom reads your column every day.
The important thing is, do your teenage children read your column every day?
I hope so. But as a token of our appreciation, we have made a donation on your behalf to YES.
Thank you so much.
And we thank you again, and keep writing, and keep challenging us, and keep asking those really hard questions of us.
Thank you very much.